Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab series on humidity sensors. My name is Brandon Fisher, and I'm an applications engineer in the temperature and humidity sensing product line. In this video, we will discuss all of the design considerations when using a humidity sensor, including package selection, thermal design, RH accuracy, case and enclosure design, and environmental conditions. By the end of this video, you will be better prepared to make system design decisions that will lead to optimal humidity sensing results. Before getting into any discussion of how to design a humidity sensing system, let's first discuss the different package options of common IC humidity sensors. We will cover only the most common capacitive style of integrated humidity sensors here, but you will see similar variants for resistive style humidity sensors where applicable. The standard and most common style of capacitive integrated humidity sensor is a surface mount like the HTC 2080 pictured here. The HTC 2080 pictured is in a DFN, or dual-sided unleaded package, but some manufacturers make leaded humidity sensors as well. The primary benefit of this package type is the cost when compared to other SMT package styles, and the familiar ease of use that comes with manufacturing. It should be noted that in this package, these sensors often require no clean assembly processes to prevent contamination of the exposed sensing element. The second common style of humidity sensor package is a WCSP. These WCSP-style sensors are essentially bare silicon die with a protective backside coating that have solder balls attached on the underside for electrical contact. Because these devices do not have packages and can be manufactured in fewer steps, they are typically the cheapest and smallest option available to designers. Sensors in this form factor will still require a no-clean assembly process, and not all board assemblers can handle WCSP-style packaging. The last two styles of humidity sensor package type are similar to the SMT style, but with additional protection for the sensing element. The first includes a manufacturer-installed protective assembly tape, which protects the sensor during assembly so that a no-clean process can be avoided and the system can be assembled more efficiently. The downside is, of course, that this tape must be manually removed after assembly. There is also the common option of a protective filter-style sensor. The qualities of this filter will vary based on the manufacturer and the specific part, but unlike the previous option, this filter is intended to be left on and does not eliminate the need for a no-clean process. These filters can be hydrophobic, waterproof, and protect sensing elements from dust and debris without interfering with the performance of the humidity sensor. Though the primary function of the humidity sensors we just discussed is to measure atmospheric moisture, relative humidity is also a function of temperature. For that reason, most digital relative humidity sensors will also include an integrated temperature sensor to help with making accurate measurements. Since measurements of RH are ambient air measurements, for best results, your design should follow proper layout guidelines for ambient temperature measuring. There is valuable material on this in our TI Precision Lab series on temperature sensors, but we can summarize the basics along with some examples very quickly here. When measuring ambient temperature, a good thermal layout will maximize the thermal resistance between the sensor and erroneous heat sources. This can be other ICs that generate heat through power consumption, displays, high current traces, or power sources. There are a few techniques or methods for doing this, but in general it is good to pursue a layout like the example shown here, wherein the sensor is placed far from the other board components that generate heat. This typically puts the sensor at one of the corners or edges of your layout. You may also notice that the ground plane here is crosshatched. This is because the copper will transfer heat faster than the PCB dielectric material, so by using a crosshatched ground plane, the thermal resistance to the sensor is also increased. This type of layout works in most situations, but when system requirements need a smaller board, it may be beneficial to use additional routing to increase the thermal resistance and reduce the thermal mass. Here the sensor is placed on the same board, but a perforation is routed to further isolate it. Similar to the benefits of crosshatching the ground plane due to the higher thermal conductance of copper, the rate of heat transfer from the rest of the board will be lower when PCB gaps are properly used. Another popular method of isolation is to route a cutout around the sensor. This method essentially creates a second PCB within a single board fabrication. By using this routing, there is also a noticeable improvement, or reduction, in the thermal response time of the sensor and board system. To understand what thermal response time is and why it is important for humidity sensors, we will first have to understand that thermal response time is analogous to the response time of an RC circuit, and accordingly is a measurement of the amount of time it takes for a sensor to respond to a step change in temperature. In this graph, the red line shows the sensor system response to a step change in temperature from 26 degrees C to 24 degrees C. You can see that the system temperature will lag behind the actual temperature due to the amount of time it takes for the sensor and board surrounding it to exchange heat with the ambient air. Similar to electrical circuits, we express this time using the 1 tau value, or the amount of time it takes to reach roughly 63% of the final value. In this case, the 1 tau response time for this system is around 60 seconds. This type of step change in temperature is not really common in humidity sensing applications, so let's also consider a model that is a little more realistic. Let's look at the same system response, but with a different style of temperature change. Now the ambient environment is constantly moving between 26 and 24 degrees C in a sinusoidal fashion. Because of the slow thermal response time relative to the changing environment, the sensor is never able to catch up with the actual readings, and our sensor accuracy suffers, at points by more than half a degree C. To translate this to humidity results, we can use a convenient rule of thumb. A good quick way to estimate your temperature-induced RH error is that for every 1 degree C your sensor is off, you'll see around a 1% difference in RH measurement. So now you understand how and why to design your board and system to get good temperature accuracy. Let's quickly discuss RH accuracy, as some aspects can be unintuitive. We can measure RH accuracy versus both ambient RH and temperature, but more commonly we display it like so, as RH sensor accuracy versus ambient relative humidity. We measure this by putting the sensor into a controlled relative humidity chamber and performing an RH sweep, first from low percent RH to high percent RH, and then from high percent RH to low percent RH. The sensor measurement error is taken as a difference between the RH sensor reading and the reading of a calibrated reference. You may notice that the two resulting curves do not agree, so we take the actual sensor accuracy as the average between them. This is because of the effects of RH hysteresis, which is a term used in this context to describe the absolute difference between the low-high and high-low sweeps. Also note that though both curves are shown here centered around zero, you should be aware that this is not always the case, and they may be centered anywhere within the accuracy limits of your sensor. In the case of poor system design, we can see the introduction of an offset into our set of accuracy curves that will shift the mean value upward. For that reason, it is important when testing your system to use this method of assessing RH accuracy. If, for example, a system designer tested the accuracy only at a single point, they may miss the introduced offset or make an incorrect reading of the system RH accuracy. A crucial part of maintaining RH accuracy in any system is the design of the case. Because of the relationship between internal and external temperature, pressure, airflow, and the mechanical structure of a case, it is very difficult to look at a case design and say for certain how much it will affect your final RH system accuracy. But I see humidity sensors typically have an exposed RH sensing element and polymer that are vulnerable to contamination and should be deployed into their final application with some kind of physical protection. What we can do, however, is make some general remarks about what every case designer for an RH system should consider. For that purpose, we'll take a look at a generic thermostat case design. Inside this thermostat, we may have additional components, but most notable for us is the RH sensor in the top left corner of our board, with a cutout around it for good thermal isolation and thermal mass reduction. To get a good percent RH accuracy, it is intuitive that this thermostat must have good airflow from the ambient air to the sensor. The simplest way to do that in this design is to include either vents or perforations on top of the case. It is worth noting that there is not any one solution to airflow, though. There are many acceptable ways to provide ventilation to the sensor, and these are independent of the package type that the designer selected. The best method for providing airflow will ultimately depend on the desired system form factor and board layout. As a rule, it is also beneficial to create smaller, separate air volumes surrounding your humidity sensor to decrease the effective volume of air that your design's vents are exchanging. Case design features for sufficient airflow must be balanced with consideration to sensor exposure. Since most RH sensors have some level of susceptibility to chemical cleaners, and most deployed systems will eventually need to be cleaned and maintained, it makes sense that having a vent directly over your sensor would not be ideal. In most cases, the solutions can be fairly simple mechanically. The vents we talked about in the previous slide can simply be offset to prevent chemical sprays from making direct contact with the sensing element during cleaning, or additional internal or external covers can be used for the same purpose. Either of these solutions will provide at least modest protection for your sensor. The final and among the most important design considerations for working with humidity sensors is the environmental conditions that the final system will be deployed into. There are a couple concerns here specifically for humidity sensing systems that we will address. First, the presence of liquid droplets from aerosols and sprays in the environment needs to be considered, especially those that contain chemicals known to be harmful to your sensor. These may be more common in healthcare or laboratory settings where cleaning is required often and regularly. Additional physical sensor protection, even more than we just discussed, should be included in those cases. Similarly, dust and particulate matter are common environmental pollutants and will affect some sensors more than others. Your sensor manufacturer should be able to provide some details on how well their devices handle dust. Condensation is a side effect of high RH levels or sudden changes in temperature and can cause electrical shorts or erroneous readings in large enough amounts. Similarly, sensors should be protected from precipitation for the same reason. If the environment will be consistently high humidity, then a hydrophobic protective filter style sensor may be beneficial. Another big consideration that we haven't yet discussed is the presence of vapors and gases. Strong chemical vapors can have the same effect as direct chemical contact with the sensor if their concentration is high enough, and atmospheric gases and pollutants may simply render some industrial environments unsuitable for IC humidity sensors. If your sensor manufacturer does not have experience with your specific environmental conditions, you may need to perform some additional component testing to ensure that the selected sensor will not degrade in performance over time. With that, we will conclude this video. You should now have an understanding of the types of unique design considerations required to create a system using humidity sensors. Thank you for watching. For more information and videos on humidity sensors, please visit ti.com/humidity.